Yes, I welcome you again, our viewers, to this very exciting moment of Family Debates. Yes, Family Debates are a program that sensitizes people about family. And God has been using this program, you know, to help settle some crises in our family. Today, we want to be looking at two very important points, though these two points are hinged upon a topic known as in-law palaver. In-laws palaver. Yes, in-laws palaver. You heard me right. I have two people with me this afternoon that will do justice to this issue. First and foremost, let me introduce my guests to you. By my left hand side, I have Mrs. Adedare. You are welcome to this program.
Thank you, sir.
And by my right hand side here, I have Mrs. Adeli. Mrs. Adeli, you are welcome to this program.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Yes, what we want to look at again is family palavers. Thank you very much. We'll be right back. Okay, you are welcome back again after this the short break. So today, we want to look at a scenario that happened in a particular family that involved the mother-in-law. The mother-in-law came visiting. That is the mother of the husband. The mother-in-law came visiting the couple. Though the mother had earlier informed the son, her own son, of her coming, but the wife stood vehemently against it, that the mother needs to inform her too before she started coming. So we want to look at which one is right. What is right? Does the mother-in-law, the mother of the husband, does she really need to take permission from the wife actually before she starts to come? So let's go straight away to Mrs. Adedai to hear her view on this very important thing.
Thank you. Well, I will say that it is very, very important for either the mother-in-law or the husband to inform the wife about the visitation of his mother or before her visitation, whichever way it may be. The reason being that marriage is in between the two of them, the man and
the wife.
So there is a need for the wife to be very, very informed, to be adequately informed about the coming of the mother. Why? The first point I'm going to be talking about is availability. The mother-in-law coming into the family to visit, how is she sure that the wife is around?
She's not coming to see the wife.
She's coming to see the family. But it is the woman that is supposed to take care of the mother that is coming to visit, and not the husband. So it is very, very important for the woman to be available. So I'm talking about availability
of the wife
who holds the so-called home. So it is very, very important for the woman of that family to be aware that her mother-in-law is coming to visit them. So that is my first point.
Oh, thank you very much. It's getting sporadic. Yes, Ms. Adeli, I believe you have some things to say about this.
I'm a mother and I have a mother-in-law. My mother-in-law doesn't need to take permission from me before visiting us. As a result of the love she has towards us, the children and the grandchildren, that was why she chose to pay us a visit. Now, when you look at the dictionary meaning of permission, when you request for a permission, that means permission means authorization or taking a consent from a person in authority. So now, when you're taking permission, that means you need an approval That means you are asking the wife to give you an answer of yes or no, which is not done. Now, when my mother-in-law should visit me, all she needs to do is to inform me and not to request for permission. Now, I want to establish this point, this first point, which is relationship based. From the book of Psalm chapter 11, verse 3,
okay,
it says, when the foundation is faulty, what can the righteous do? This has to do with relationship. What is the relationship between the wife and the mother-in-law? What is the foundation of the relationship? How did they start it? If the relationship is cordial, then the wife will not have any challenge or challenges with the fact that she's coming, requesting for permission or not. But if the relationship is not cordial and they have relationship crisis right from the foundation, then there will be issue.
Oh, thank you very much. You know, in this area of our country, some wives have phobia for the visit of their mother-in-law, the mother of the husband. They have phobia. I want to ask, why is it so? Do they see the mother-in-law as witch or what? Why do you think they have phobia for the mother-in-law, the wives?
Thank you very much. Well, to me, I don't have any phobia for mother-in-law. Fortunately, I don't have one. Well, to me, I don't have phobia. Even if I have, I don't have phobia for mother-in-law things. Okay? Now, the reason why I think most women have phobias for their mother-in-law is depend on the relationship.
Okay.
That's my sister has just talked about. You know, it depends on the way the mother-in-law relates with their wives. Some mother-in-law are very harsh. Some are very cool. Cool-headed, they are calm. You don't have issues with them. Even if you are going haywire, you see some mother-in-laws trying to put the wife, you know, trying to correct the wife. But we have some mother-in-laws, they will just talk shabbily to the wife in a way that the wife doesn't want. So that is the issue we are having, and it's based on relationship.
Okay, and it's based on a relationship. Do you agree that some wives actually have phobia for their mother-in-laws, and as a result of that, they don't want them around? They want only themselves and the husband. Should it be so?
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. You know, there's something trending among the youths of nowadays.
Okay.
Especially the young girls. They will tell you, oh, I pray my mother-in-law die before I get married to
you. You are very correct.
And you know, they are forgotten
that they will become mothers.
They are saying indirectly that they will die before they become a mother-in-law to someone. You know, by the time I, as a mother, once my son gets married, I believe that he has already left to cleave to the wife. And as a mother-in-law, I don't go to the house to instruct my wife or my daughter-in-law how to
run
the affairs of her home. No, I'm going there because of the love, the unwavering love I have towards them. So for some wives who have phobia with the presence of their mother-in-law, I think they have a personality problem.
Personality problem.
Yes, they have identity problem. Because if you know that what you're doing is, you're doing it well, you're doing it right, you shouldn't have a phobia that, oh, my mother-in-law is coming. Oh, I don't know how to. No, it shouldn't be.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. We will be right back.
Get to watch inspiring and faith-lifting movies online from Divine Grace Evangelical Ministry. Subscribe to our YouTube channel now, Digam TV. We act to win souls for God.
Welcome looking at is family palavras. The influence of the third person, especially the mother-in-law in the family. My two guests have spoken their minds concerning the first point. The second point, the second scenario, this rant, is the mother-in-law, that is the mother of the husband, wants his son to have three children. The mother of the husband wants her son to have three children, and they already had two. So the wife insists that she will not accept two. The mother-in-law also insists that they should make it three. That if the wife will not be willing to make it three, she won't mind to go out and get a young girl for the husband to make children for her son. Now, the husband is like in a fix. Whose instruction should the husband listen to, or whose instruction, yes, should the husband take? Is it that of the wife or that of the mother? So, my guest, you have had it. What do you feel?
Thank you, moderator, sir. Well, I will say that the wife, the husband, should take the husband's instruction.
Again,
I will say that the husband should take to the wife's instruction with reasons. The two of them are one. The mother-in-law is not to dictate to the couple. Before the two couples met, they had an agreement probably that they are going to give birth to maybe two children or so. So it is not the right of the mother-in-law to now dictate to them that they must give birth to more than two children. More so, she is not the one that will carry the pregnancy.
Okay.
It is the wife that will carry the pregnancy.
Okay.
So if she wished to go ahead and get another wife for the husband, let her go ahead.
All right. You have had a point. What's your take on this?
Yes, she is not to carry the pregnancy. She is not to carry the burden of the pregnancy. But I want to remind us, this same mother-in-law has experienced this in the past. In fact, without her, there cannot be the man who is the husband.
Exactly.
So the mother-in-law has been the container, the root at which this man came to this world before the wife could marry him. So she understands and she knows what it takes for a mother to carry the pregnancy. And she knows that if she can carry this pregnancy for 9 months and labor over this son that you got married to, if she can do that successfully, then you too should be able to do that. Then I find it, there's another thing that says, what another person says,
why sit down?
A young man,
if he climbs upon the tree,
if you like, climb one the tallest tree, you can never see it. So she's talking from experience.
Yeah.
Though sometimes the women, we youth, or the married couples, may be thinking, what is this woman saying? She may not be able to pass the knowledge to the person, but she has a reason.
A reason. That's a very good one. She has a reason.
Please, okay. I'm very sorry to come in. Now, looking at the economic situation of the country, you know, this so-called mother-in-law, she's not the one that will feed the child. Even though they are not having children, they already have two on ground.
No, we don't know the gender of the two. Maybe the two of the two children
are
the
boys.
Yeah.
No matter the gender. No matter the gender of these children, once they have agreed that this is what they want to do, that agreement should bind them together. And apart from that, what about the economic situation? Now, looking at the economic situation of the country, what if they don't have the financial capacity
to raise three children.
And another thing is, this set of mother or this kind of mother-in-laws, they will just push their children to such problems. And at the end of it, they will not even stay long.
Madam, it may not be a problem. It could even be blessed in disguise. So
it could, but it is not 100% a blessing.
So, okay, what if
it may not be 100%.
So having more children now could become problematic.
Since the couple have agreed to give back.
No, the husband actually wanted to have one more, just like the mother suggested. But because the wife is saying, no, we have agreed on this, your mother cannot come to my home and be telling us what to do. So on that basis, the husband...
Well, if it is on that ground, yes, the wife can come down. They can talk together, you know, they can discuss, we'll have a round table discussion, then talk it out. But everything boils down on the two of them. And not on the mother-in-law.
Yes.
The mother-in-law doesn't have any say. If the wife so desires that, yes, she wants to support the husband and have it, she is the one that will carry it.
All right, let's hear the opinion.
And not the mother-in-law dictate.
I love the point you just mentioned. That means the wife can step down and agree, and that's to the tune of the mother-in-law. Mother-in-laws are not wicked.
They are not.
They are mothers.
Mm.
Yes, if you consider the economic factor of it, if you think, if you will to give your children, all of them, to your mother-in-law, she will gladly accept them.
Mm.
And she will raise them up, just the way she raised your husband.
Okay. Now, are we generally now saying that the husband should, in this matter, listen to what the mother, his mother is saying?
Yes.
Okay.
No. If the husband is also in support of it, then the wife can come down, talk with the husband and agree.
Yes. I want to say yes. He should listen to the mother-in-law because he's his mother. And the mother will always want the best for him. A mother will not want to harm or hurt the son. Because I don't know how many of you have experienced a woman traveling during labor to bring forth a child. You can't go through that pain and want to hurt your son. There's a popular saying that says the kind of pain a woman goes through during labor is likened to the pain of death.
Hmm.
So a mother sacrificed a lot of things. She sacrifices her time, her money, her energy, her career, her sleep, her beauty, her figure 8. So she sacrifices her beauty, her figure 8, her career, her sleep, just to give the son the best. So if a woman can do this, then she doesn't want the son to be hurt, or even the wife, who is the daughter-in-law, to be hurt. She wants the best for them.
Yeah, thank you for your tips. Yes, we may not entirely say this is what the husband should do. But at this very point in time, we want to listen to your own comments too. Should the husband take to what the mother said or what the wife is saying? Whatever your comment is, please drop your comment for us on this same YouTube, or you send it to us on our Facebook account, Digger TV Facebook account, or you send it through WhatsApp. Our WhatsApp number is 080-3965-6089. We are also on Instagram, Digger TV. Drop your comment there. So, my guest, please, your conclusion, briefly.
Well, I would still want to talk about agreement. Amos 3:3 says, can two work together except they agree? So there is a need for the wife and the husband to agree on whether to have a third child or not.
Okay, thank you very much. Your own
conclusion. I would like to conclude by saying there is a scripture that says, if your earthly parents knows how to give you good gifts,
how much more?
So God knows that even your parents, your mother-in-law can give you good gifts. I'm not to hurt you. Thank
you. Alright, thank you. You send your comment to us. Until we see again next time on this same family debate series, I remain yours, Adedare Olusegun. Thank you. God bless you.